It's obvious some of our players are doping. How are some guys getting older, yet thinner and fitter? How are they recovering from injuries so fast?
I think it would take an astounding amount of naivety to believe there's not PEDs in the NBA. The incentive right now in the NBA is too great. They're handing out $10 million contracts, $15 million contracts to guys that are seventh on the bench, eighth on the bench. This league is flush with money. When that's the case, there are players dying, willing to cheat, to be a part of it. You can guarantee it. And it has nothing in that respect to do with basketball, any sport, any game of life for that matter. With that much money involved, people are going to be willing to cheat to get there. Show me a sport and I'll show you a dirty sport.
So it was the summer of 2012 and I had just finished my junior year of high school. I'd spent the entire season riding the bench and I promised myself that I would do whatever it took to become a starter the following year. So when I got home, I started by going on Google and searching NBA workouts. I wanted to learn from the best, and what better way to learn than from NBA players themselves. As I was scouring the internet, I came across Kobe's offseason routine. He called it his 666 workout. And the reason he called it that was because he used to train for 6 hours a day, 6 days a week, for 6 months out of the year. Kobe used to wake up at 4 in the morning and take a helicopter down to the Lakers practice facility and put up shots from 5 to 7 a.m. Then he'd be back home and sleep for a couple of hours only to be back at the facility a few hours later doing track work from 11 in the morning until 2 in the afternoon. And then from 6 to 8 in the evening, he'd be back in the weight room and doing it in his own words, heavy, hard, can't feel your arms type lifting. And this is all documented in his book, The Mamba Mentality. In Kobe's 20-year NBA career, he played in 1,346 games, averaging 36 minutes per contest, winning 5 NBA titles, 2 Finals MVPs, both of them without Shaq. We've all heard the stories of Kobe's unbelievable work ethic, and we can all agree the Mamba was built different. Kobe is one of my favorite players because of his determination to win, his insane work ethic, and his commitment to his craft for so many years. I learned so much from him, and this is not meant in any way to be a knock on Kobe's legacy, but with the amount of work he put his body through for 2 decades, I hate to say this, but it just didn't seem possible that he would have been able to do it without some sort of assistance. Now, you're probably going to dislike this video, unsub, and say something mean in the comments section, but before you do that, please, please, please just watch the video until the very end. I promise you, I have some good points to support my argument, and it'll open your eyes to a possibility you may have never considered. When you see plays like this, or even these ones,
defense, that's what it is all about. Morant on the drone.
You never assume it's steroids, and that's because society and the media have led us to believe that if someone is taking performance-enhancing drugs, they look like a bodybuilder, which is simply not true. People are shocked and horrified when they find out a famous athlete has gotten caught for using a banned substance when they didn't even look like they were taking anything. And that's where the disconnect happens. You see, there are different forms of performance-enhancing drugs. Yes, some of them accelerate your body's ability to build muscle by artificially increasing your body's natural testosterone levels, and these are classified as anabolic steroids. But in a separate class, there are also peptides and human growth hormones. For athletes who are growth hormone deficient, this allows them to put on muscle faster, increase skeletal mass, reduce body fat percentage, gives them higher energy levels, and increases their work capacity. In addition, some of the other benefits of HGH offset the effects of aging and muscle degeneration, resulting in a longer career. There are also EPOs, which help an athlete increase their aerobic capacity so they're able to continue to perform at a high level late in the season and during long stretches in a game.
Haymakers at each other. Butler drives, and he's fouled. And Butler right now is exhausted with 46.7 remaining. He's got 2 free throws to get.
Now, I'm not an expert in pharmacology, and I'm only scratching the surface here, but when people say steroids wouldn't make it any easier for a player to put a basketball into a basket, it would negatively affect a player's ability to perform because they'd be carrying too much muscle, based on what we've seen in players like Zion, Giannis, and a handful of others, I have to disagree. In addition to that, it's also not a strong enough argument when there are different subcategories of banned substances that not only make your muscles bigger, but also help you recover in less time, increase bone density, as well as stamina. But Tristan, if players were actually cheating, they would have been caught already. In 1983, the NBA developed their first anti-drug policy to stop the widespread use of cocaine throughout the league, and other forms of substances that could give players a competitive advantage over others. Since then, only 11 players have gotten caught for using a banned substance. So does that mean the NBA is the cleanest of all major American sports? Well, the answer is not that simple. The NBA's collective bargaining agreement states a player must undergo drug testing no more than 4 times in a season, 2 during the regular season and 2 in the off-season. A third-party drug testing organization conducts these drug tests and selects a few random players without prior notice. The NBA, the Players Association, or any team or player will not choose the players getting tested. That's up to the third-party organization. But here's where the bargaining agreement treads into murky waters. First, the organization conducting the drug test must let the team know when a scheduled collection will happen. Then, once the team is aware that a drug test will happen, they can notify the players, giving them enough time to rid the drugs from their systems. A few ways players can avoid testing positive is by 1. Microdosing. This is when a player uses a small amount of the banned substance to stay below the testing trigger levels. The second way is by using designer drugs. These are steroids designed to mimic the original one, but with more chemical diversity to avoid classifying as illegal and avoiding detection in drug tests. The third way is by using diuretics, which are risky because they are also a banned substance, and you could potentially test positive by using them. Diuretics are also known as a masking agent because they reduce the concentration of the banned substance in the body by increasing urine volume, so essentially they can just pee until all the drugs leave their body. And the fourth way is by simply waiting until the substance leaves your system. EPOs have a half-life of anywhere between 6 and 9 hours, meaning that the concentration level of the substance goes down by half. So every 6 to 9 hours, it goes down another 25%, and then another 25%, and another 25% until the substance has entirely left your system or is undetectable. With the millions of dollars NBA players make, they have access to the best state-of-the-art pharmaceuticals and designer drugs. Hypothetically speaking, if they wanted an EPO with the shortest half-life because you never know when there's going to be a random drug test on such short notice, they could get that. Say the half-life of the newest state-of-the-art EPO is 6 hours. If we do the math, it takes just 30 hours for the EPO to entirely leave the athlete's body. So if they know 48 hours ahead of time that a drug test is going to happen, all they need to do is make sure they don't take any banned substances until after 48 hours. It's not that hard. And with PED scientists creating new and harder to detect drugs every year, anti-doping organizations will always be one step behind. When a player fails to pass a drug test, they lose 25% of their salary. They also get suspended and miss a quarter of the season. If the player plays an integral role in their team's success, this will result in the team losing games, and it also messes up the team's chemistry. If they're an all-star, they could lose half of their fan base, brands would stop sponsoring them, and they could potentially get canceled. In addition, any significant achievement they may have accomplished in their careers may now be considered insignificant by the media. So why would an athlete even take that risk when there's so much at stake if they get caught? Well, the first motive is money. Suppose you play in the G League and earn $30,000 a year. You just had a kid and now you have a family to take care of. And the one thing separating you from playing on an NBA team and making a minimum salary of $900,000 a year is taking a banned substance? Would you do it? The round mound of rebound himself, Sir Charles Barkley, said he would.
I grew up poor. If somebody told me I could take a shot in my ass, hit 50, 60 home runs, and make $17, $20 million a year, I'm not going to get on here and be a hypocrite. I'm going
to
do it.
When there's a financial incentive, people are willing to cheat. The second reason is to recover faster. The average NBA season has 82 games, except for this season, which has 72 due to the pandemic. But that doesn't change the fact NBA players still endure a physically demanding schedule. This is a list of the 15 best scorers in the league this season. These players have played a minimum of 40 games and are the go-to guys when their team needs a bucket. Across the board, they're playing anywhere between 30 and 36 minutes per contest and run an average distance of 2.55 miles per game, equivalent to 10 laps around a standard racing track. But as we all know, basketball isn't a game where you just run in a straight line. These players are constantly jumping, moving forward and back, side to side, they're colliding with other grown men, taking hits, taking charges, getting fouled. When they're not playing in a nationally televised basketball game, they're participating in team practices, working on individual skills, improving their athletic abilities off the court, and trying to build muscular strength to endure the physical nature of the game. And how could we forget the travel? Every team in the NBA is traveling from one city to another and constantly changing time zones. Some nights they're playing back-to-back games with a team practice the very next morning, and they're doing this for 6 months out of the year, longer if you count the playoffs. People will argue and say, well, they're able to do that because technology is advanced. Players have access to things like better trainers, cryotherapy, personal chefs, massage therapists. They have an entire team of professionals that can help them recover and train better. While that's true, then why are players still doping? In 2019, three players tested positive for using banned substances. DeAndre Ayton tested positive for using diuretics. Wilson Chandler, who played for the Nets, tested positive for eipamorelin, a growth hormone. John Collins tested positive for growth hormone as well. In 2018, Jody Meeks tested positive for eipamorelin, the same growth hormone Wilson Chandler used. In 2017, Joakim Noah tested positive for ligandrol, a designer drug used to mimic the effects of steroids to increase lean muscle mass faster. In 2013, Hito Turkoglu tested positive for methenolone, an anabolic steroid. In 2011, OJ Mayo tested positive for DHEA, a growth hormone that boosts testosterone production, slows down the natural changes in the body that come with aging, and helps build muscle tissue. In 2016, he was dismissed and disqualified from the NBA for using another banned substance. In 2009, Rashard Lewis tested positive for DHEA. The proof is in the pudding, guys. NBA players are using PEDs despite the fact there have been technological advances in recovery and the myth it wouldn't help basketball players. With the amount of work these players are putting their bodies through, they can't do it if they don't have a drug protocol. And if you guys are finding this video interesting so far, make sure to smash the like button so YouTube recommends this video to more people. Help you make that YouTube money, baby! When you're a competitor, you will do anything to gain an advantage over the next guy. In 2011, when LeBron couldn't win a championship in Cleveland, he took his talents to South Beach to join Chris Bosh and D-Wade, creating the NBA's first super team. He was expected to win by everyone. At the time, he hadn't won his first chip, and everyone was doubting the king. Fortunately, in his four seasons with the Heat, he won two championships, silencing all the haters and cementing himself in the GOAT conversation. But in 2013, IBN Sports Wrap covered a story about an employee named Jessica, who worked for a health clinic just outside of Miami called Biogenesis of America. The founder, a man by the name of Anthony Bosch, infamously known for supplying PEDs to top baseball players such as A-Rod, Milwaukee Brewers outfielder Ryan Braun, and a handful of others connected to the Biogenesis scandal in 2013. Jessica worked as an assistant for Bosch and kept track of pretty much every financial transfer at the clinic. While keeping track of these financial transfers, one of the initials that stood out to her were LJ, who she claimed to believe was LeBron James. Jessica said that a man by the name Mr. Paul came in every month, once a month, to pick up products for the initials LJ. As for what those products were, Jessica didn't know. However, she did say that Mr. Paul was a friend of LJ's, and coincidentally enough, LeBron's best friend and agent's name is Rich Paul. There's no confirmation that Mr. Paul was in fact Rich Paul, but Jessica said some of her coworkers were 100% sure that LeBron was a client of the clinic and was the person with initials LJ. The other initials that stood out to her were JN, and confirmed that JN was former Orlando Magic point guard Jameer Nelson. She said Jameer came to the clinic in person, picked up his products, and paid in cash for them. So, is there a problem with players using PEDs and steroids in the NBA? ESPN Magazine interviewed Derrick Rose and asked him, if 1 equals what are PEDs and 10 equals everybody's juicing, how big of an issue is illegal enhancing in your sport? In response, Rose said, 7. It's huge. I think we need a level playing field where nobody has an advantage over the next person. In my opinion, I don't think PEDs necessarily create an unlevel playing field, and here's why. All these players are making millions of dollars, and they all have access to the same pharmaceuticals, and they can all pass a drug test and not get caught. In addition, they have access to doctors who can educate them and explain the risk if they decide to use hormone enhancers and EPOs. So at the end of the day, it's just up to the player and if he's willing to take the risks associated with using PEDs to take his body and his abilities to the next level. PEDs also help players extend their careers by slowing down the effects of aging and helping them recover better. I mean, how many times have you tuned in to watch your favorite team battle it out against a rival only to see that your favorite player isn't playing due to load management? So if it means that I get to see my favorite player play into his late 30s, I think that's great. I think most fans would agree as well. It's not like we want to see LBJ retire anytime soon. And honestly, it makes the game more entertaining when you have players who can jump higher and physically dominate the sport. I'm really interested in hearing your guys' thoughts on the subject, so leave them in the comment section below, and I might make a part 2 in the future. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure to leave it a like. It helps the YouTube algorithm recommend this video to more people, and subscribe to my YouTube channel for more interesting videos. It takes some time for me to do my research for these types of videos, so turn on the notification bell so you never miss my latest upload. 2 videos are going to pop up on the screen. Click on one of them to support the channel. I'm Tristan Della Pena, and I'll talk to you in the next one.